The power of seeing the unseen, that's the magic of the FLIR C5. But what happens when this magic is interrupted? Let's see what's inside the package. Look at that, the camera itself. A protective case for on the go. Yep, it's a perfect fit. We also have a USB-A to USB-C cable. And of course, the usual paperwork. Nice. By the way, it seems the hand strap is missing here. Let's get rid of the box. Time to boot it up and identify the issue. Give it a moment, the camera takes some time to start up. We're stuck with this progress bar, it doesn't seem to advance beyond this. Let's take a step back, set a timer, and observe if there's any progress. I believe we can all agree that it's not moving forward.
I agree, this is a complete waste of time.
Behind this small metal cover lie two cameras, the thermal one at the top and a regular one below. The regular camera plays a key role in the MSX mode, merging thermal details with its visuals offer a richer viewing experience. Time to power down the camera. Let's set a timer to track how long it takes to get this little guy up and running again. The most straightforward way to access the thermal camera module is by taking off the metal cover. It took me a few attempts in the past to figure this out. To put in perspective, my first go with the FLIR C5 was a bit of a mess. Because of its weatherproofing, the entire case is sealed with glue, making it quite a challenge to crack it open. Here's the screen and the electronics. During my initial try, I accidentally sliced the ribbon cable, not realizing it was there when I was taking it apart. You can still see the residue of the glue on the back panel. Here's the FLIR C5 motherboard with a socket for the thermal module in view. Unfortunately, I can't show you the thermal camera module itself, as I've sold it. The battery isn't externally accessible either. You have to pop open the shell first to get to it. What a shame. Now let's refocus on our device at hand. We will gently soften the glue beneath the metal cover using the lowest setting on our hot air station. Though a hairdryer would work just as well for this step. To pry up the metal cover, we need a slim tool to slide beneath it. I'll be using a Mechanic 0.1mm disassemble sheet, typically used for lifting curved displays. If you don't have one of these on hand, a simple sheet of paper might do the trick as a makeshift alternative. Don't insert it too deeply. We want to avoid scratching anything. Our main goal here is just to soften and loosen the adhesive. Just a little bit more. Let's remove the cover. That square, reddish piece of glass acts as a filter, eliminating any undesired wavelength of light. To access the thermal camera module, we also need to take out that filter. For this step, we will follow a similar approach to the metal cover, apply some heat, and then gently pry it off. The plastic pick won't do, it's too thick. We will have to revert to the 0.1mm disassembly sheet. Let's proceed with caution to avoid any scratches. This right here is the filter, made of glass and layered with a super fine coating. With that out of the way, we have now uncovered the thermal camera module. Let's attempt to press it down using this ceramic tweezer. We should hope that this was our only problem. Time to put it back together. First we will clean the filter with a cotton swab dipped in IPA, also known as isopropyl alcohol. Once it's reinserted, we will give this side a clean as well. We will refresh the adhesive using a few drops of IPA. Let's position it just right and then press it firmly using our cotton swab. All right, let's power it up. That's strange, it's not working after our treatment. Let's power it down and try it again. I'm curious, have you ever tried a thermal camera? Let me know in the comments. A bit more notching with our tweezers and fingers crossed for positive results. Huh, still no luck. What's really going on here? I'm convinced the module is in the right spot. Let's give a safe boot a shot by switching it on and holding down the long shutter button. The asterisk beneath the FLIR logo confirmed that the combination did the trick. That audible click was from the thermal camera module. It's a great indicator. I'm quite optimistic about it booting up now. There's the thermal image. Nice. Let's turn it off and see if it restarts without a hitch. But before that, let's quickly put it back together. Time to power it on. Damn, still no luck. This device is seriously testing my patience. I will fast forward the next 5 minutes as I was double checking the thermal module and repeatedly attempting to power it on. After plugging it into a USB-C charger and performing the safe boot again, the FLIR C5 finally powered up. By the way, what you are seeing here is the shutter mechanism of the thermal camera module. It opens and closes periodically as it self-calibrates. The camera is back on, displaying the thermal image again. It's starting to seem like we have a software issue on top of the earlier LU thermal module problem. Before we proceed with a firmware upgrade, let's initiate a factory reset on the camera. After the reset, it prompts for language and time settings. Once that's done, we are greeted with our thermal image again. But the real question is, will it hold up through the next power off and on cycle? Time to put the metal cover back on, hopefully for the final time. And hey, if you're enjoying what I'm doing here, a thumbs up would be much appreciated. Guess what? We are stuck again. It's just unbelievable. Okay, switching it off, booting in safe mode, and it powers up. Taking a brief moment to enjoy the visuals. Moving on to the firmware update using the camera's built-in Wi-Fi. Of course, an error message pops up. How many issues can this product possibly have? All right, let's give it another shot. The download is done. Let's initiate the upgrade. After the camera reboots, we are back to choosing the basic settings like language and time. Setup's finished and there's our timer displayed right on the camera screen. But after all this, is it now a reliable and dependable companion through those power ons and offs? Well, the initial power cycle worked flawlessly. Warmer areas like my palm show up bright, while cooler parts like my fingers appear darker. It's a clear way to distinguish temperature differences. Let's power up the soldering iron and see its thermal signature. We can easily spot the hot bright areas and the cooler colors around them. However, the thermal image isn't perfectly aligned with the regular camera. We can adjust this in the settings by choosing a fixed focus distance. Additionally, we can switch up the color palette. Here's what it looks like in rainbow mode. Check it out, you can clearly spot where the soldering iron was placed. The blue mat retains heat in that spot. Alright, let's power cycle it 2 more times to ensure consistent performance. Power it back on and yep, it boots up. One more time. I would say we made it, but seriously, how many issues can one product have? The thermal camera module coming loose, firmware updates failing on the first try, and software bugs that stop the camera from booting up. Have you had similar experiences with this camera? Let's share and learn together. Remember, sharing is caring. Around an hour's work, not too shady.